Welcome everyone to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee's first meeting of 2022. And let me take this opportunity to wish everyone a Happy New Year. I've received apologies from Stephanie Callaghan this morning, but all other members are here. First item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 5, 6 and 7 in private. Looking to my colleagues now for their agreement on that. Thank you. And our second item today is an evidence session from our inquiry, first session in our inquiry to health and wellbeing of children and young people. I welcome to the committee Professor Hazel Borland, the Interim Chief Executive of NHS Ayrshire and Arran, Heather Connolly, the Health Psychologist for the Division of Health Psychology Scotland from the British Psychological Society, Mary Glasgow, Chief Executive of Children First, Kirsty Louise Hunt, Senior Policy and Public Affairs Lead for Barnardo's Scotland, Jackie Pepper, Chief Social Worker for Perth and Kinross Council, and Suzanne Shields, Occupational Therapy and Care Group Lead for Occupational Therapy for Children and Young People at the Royal College of Occupational Therapies. Now, the clerks have allocated one member from our committee as a lead questioner on each of our themes, but if other members want to come in, then we have a chat function on this platform. If you just put an R in the chat box and I will try and take as many supplementaries as time allows. It would be also very helpful, particularly when asking supplementary questions, if members could direct their question to one of our panellists in the first instance, because that means that everyone's clear as to when they speak. And of course, our panellists as well, if you want to come in on anything in particular, but you haven't been asked by our committee member, you can use the chat function as well and let me know you want to come in just by putting an R in the chat box. And if we do all of that, then it should work beautifully. I'm going to ask, start things off really by going round the panel very quickly to ask what issues you feel that children and young people are facing with regard to an impact on their mental and physical health and well-being at this point in time, of course, right in the middle of the pandemic, start of 2022, Omicron on the rise, and 2 years now of this pandemic. So if I go around everyone in the order in which I introduced you and start off with Professor Borland.
Many thanks, convener, much appreciated. And that's a huge question, I have to say. It is enormous. My colleagues across Ayrshire have pulled together a range of picks, and we are concerned about a number of developmental delays in infants. We are concerned about the impact on childhood obesity. We're also concerned about the interaction with dental services and the impact that that can have on broader health and well-being of children of all ages, significant impact on their mental health, which tragically is also resulting in an increase in suicides across the country. And then a range of other issues in terms of making sure that we deliver person-centred services, the stigma that can be connected with being care experienced, the impact of poverty and some concerns that at times we seem to be compartmentalising poverty in our language. So we talk about child poverty, we talk about period poverty, we talk about food and fuel poverty. Actually, it's all just poverty, and we need to tackle it in that way. The impact of COVID-19 on education and the impact of that on the attainment gap. Then when you look at the broader issues in terms of social media, and then thinking about all those things and their impact on some of our public health priorities in terms of breastfeeding, smoking in pregnancy, gender-based violence, and the impact that that can have in particular on young people, and a particular focus on young girls. So there's a whole range of issues there, convener, and I'm more than happy during the course of the evidence base to answer questions on a range of those things in more detail. I guess I didn't want to go into too much detail right at the beginning, but more than happy throughout the meeting to respond to any questions that colleagues may have.
Thank you, and I appreciate it. It is a very wide question, and I mean, my colleagues are ready to dig into some of the detail of that. And of course, as well, our inquiry is a big theme, but with a very short timescale, but I'm hoping it will be a springboard for some more focused work, and we'll be inviting you back as we do that. Can I come to Heather Connolly now?
Good morning, Convener, and thank you for having me here today. So I'm representing the Division of Health Psychology, so that's much more a focus on general health and wellbeing of the population and individual level, and also about how we support systems that we're all supported in to think more psychologically informed in the way that we provide support to people. So kind of less on the specialised mental health aspect. But I think as Professor Borland gave out a broad array of the difficulties and the challenges that children and young people are facing just now. And I think that again just emphasises the wider determinants that are impacting our children and young people and all humans, particularly within this COVID-19 pandemic. And I think just reiterating what Professor Borland said, I think a lot of things around our mental health and well-being for children has been impacted significantly. Also our obesity and our diet and nutrition, our physical activity, our social connectedness, the relationships that we have with people and the relationships we have with children. They might not have been attending as much as school or nursery, and some people have been taken out of school because of fear of the COVID-19 and things like that. So actually the relationships and taking it back down to the relationships that we have with our children and young people and how we engage them then in all the fantastic services that we have out there, I think is really, really important as well. I think from the biggest one, I think again reflecting on what Professor Borland said, was that about child poverty. I think that's one of our biggest difficulties right now in our society, about poverty. And I think unfortunately that's only going to get worse given our energy crisis and everything like that. So I think that trying to tackle child poverty kind of gets down to the core of some of the difficulties that children have growing up and that young people growing up in terms of access to certain services, in terms of ability to go to community groups and have those relationships with other children and younger people. So I think the tackling of child poverty and poverty in general, I think, is really, really important, because again, when we think about all of the wider determinants that impact our health and wellbeing, poverty kind of sits in the middle of that, because if we don't have that ability to access stuff, if we have that stress and burden of worrying about financial difficulties, then that impacts on all of our health and wellbeing.
Yeah, thank you. And I think that's going to come out very strongly in the questions around child poverty. And as you say, those outside determinants that are affecting the household incomes, adding additional stressors. Mary Glasgow, can I come to you?
Yeah, first of all, thank you very much, Convener, and the committee for the opportunity to submit written evidence, and also for the invitation to appear this morning to speak on behalf of the children and families that we support at Children First. Very similar to colleagues who've already spoken, so there are very broad themes by any measure. Every aspect of children and young people's development has been impacted by the pandemic and the associated restrictions. So we hear and we see children, young people and their families who are isolated, who are struggling with general levels of anxiety. So we take a whole family approach, and we know that when parents are anxious, parents and carers are anxious about money, when they're anxious about restrictions, about relatives, about what's happening in the broader context, then children pick up on that. So we've seen huge increase in the level of anxiety and pressure on family. What that's meant for children individually is often a rise in their own level of anxiety, and sit that alongside the loss of peer and social relationships, the loss of time at school, which for many of the children that we support is a place of safety when home and family relationships are not always safe. We've seen children lose out on sports activities, community activities. So normal developmental milestones over the past 2 years have been lost for a whole generation of children and young people, whatever stage that we've been at. So we've got teenagers who have had far less opportunity to take risks to mix with others outside of home. They've lost opportunities to go off and do, you know, Duke of Edinburgh Awards or experience other aspects of normal things that children and young people need to do. So there's general aspects of their development that have been delayed. And then we've seen very specific increase in the level of distress, anxiety and harm that children have experienced because of the losses that they've come across. And one of the single biggest things has been the difficulty that children, young people and their families talk to us about reaching out and getting support in a timely fashion. That it was really difficult before the pandemic. There was a lack of support to recover from the impact of trauma. It was very difficult to access quickly good quality support for children who were experiencing emotional distress or mental health difficulties. That got a lot worse through the pandemic. And so we've seen children's challenges around their anxiety and their mental and emotional health being exacerbated, made worse. And parents and carers really at the end of their tether, very distressed, not knowing where to turn. And when universal services are not available as a first step into support, they've really been at a loss to try and access timely help for children. So we've seen that get worse. So my, you know, one of my big concerns is it was bad before in that sphere. Before the pandemic, it's been made a lot worse. And of course, the biggest thing, as other colleagues have said, is the growing impact of poverty and the anxiety and uncertainty and the difficulty that that places on family relationships. Family relationships, you know, we always see children and young people do well when families do well, when parents do well and feel safe and secure. And right now we are seeing an incredible amount of anxiety, pressure and worry about poverty and the impact of poverty on families generally. So there's a kind of general issue, and then there are very specific issues for some of the children and young people that we support at Children First.
Thank you, Mary. Can I come to Kirsty Louise Hunt?
Thank you, convener, and just like to also just thank the opportunity to be able to speak to the committee today on behalf of the children and families that Barnardo's Scotland supports. I would echo a lot, I think, of what's been said already. Particularly, I would echo what Mary Glasgow had said there, particularly about the concerns on the impact of poverty. What we have found, especially since children have returned full time to school after the disruption of lockdowns, is that there's been a lot of anxiety and concerns around children's mental health, around the disruption that's been caused over the last 18 months, almost 2 years now. We had actually put out a survey to Barnardo Scotland staff that are based in schools around what they are seeing in the children and young people that we work with. And what's came back from that is that actually the vast majority of staff, 94%, came back and said they feel children and young people have a lot more worries now than they did pre-pandemic. There's also a great level of concern about the impact of financial hardship that's been made worse over the course of the pandemic. And I think just what to echo and really what to kind of highlight to the committee is a lot of these issues are perhaps not new. They are issues that we have known about before the pandemic, but the impact of the pandemic and the social isolation that's been caused by that and the impact on developmental milestones has just made that so much worse. From that survey that I'd mentioned, I think over 83% of our staff came back and said that they see families with more financial hardship now than they did prior to March 2020. That's like a really, really key concern for us. And I think just in terms of Mary Glasgow had also picked it up, you know, children will get overwhelmed and stressed if the adults that are caring for them in their lives are also experiencing difficulties. So I think that's the key thing that we want to see. We want to see a whole family approach taken to supporting families and children and young people. And we'd like to see, I think, much more investment and focus on that early intervention and that kind of whole family supports that are available.
Thank you very much. And can I come to Jackie Pepper?
Thank you, convener, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to the committee this morning. And I am Chief Social Work Officer for Perth and Kinross Council, but also representing Social Work Scotland as Chair of the Standing Committee for Children and Families. And the Children and Family Standing Committee have met monthly throughout the pandemic and more often if required. And there's been pretty close monitoring of the issues that families are facing. And I would echo all of the comments that you've received already, but I'd like to pick up on some key issues for particular groups of children, if I may. So, for example, young carers and the impact of caring responsibilities. So, with in the initial phases of the pandemic, with lockdown and the withdrawal of universal services, so the impact on the mental health of young carers has been significant. In that, those are young people who face isolation, and they often lack the support that other children can engage in. So that's been a concern for us. Also, I would highlight care leavers, so young people who are care experienced and are living independently, often without the support of families and key relationships. So the isolation and lack of support that young people who've left care has had an impact on their mental health in particular. And we've seen an increase in the likelihood of self-harm. And I think we also heard earlier about there has been an increase in suicidal attempts and suicide. And high demand for mental health services at an acute level. Just to reflect on what's been said earlier by other contributors, that where mental health and the well-being of parents is affected, then that's likely to have a direct impact on children and young people, where their, you know, family circumstances are impacted by drug and alcohol misuse, depression, poverty, poor mental health. There's a direct correlation with the well-being of children. And also, I would highlight the needs of children with disabilities. And we're seeing a linkage to poor mental health in parents, because their packages of care have perhaps been either withdrawn or they have withdrawn themselves from it. So they have become more isolated. So although those things are beginning to be reintroduced, you know, they are tired, they are still experiencing the distress of everything that they've experienced over 18 months now. And one of the things that we've also seen, just by seeking information from our members, is an increase in young people who require care or residential school provision, because their parents are unable to manage, or they're unable to be managed within mainstream provisions. So an increase in concerns and an increase in young people, in some instances, moving into care provision as well. And I would also echo the comments that were made about that need to look at the whole family, and the whole family, to really tackle issues of poverty and health and well-being. Because anything that positively impacts on families will positively impact on children, and their outcomes are inextricably linked. So that's where I would start. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. And we are very aware of the fact that this is not just, you know, a health issue. This goes across a whole lot of disciplines. And with that in mind, we have reached out to other parliamentary committees as well to work with them on all the different drivers that are affecting children and young people's mental and physical health. And finally, just on this initial question that I've put to you, can I come to Suzanne Shields?
Morning, convener. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak today. I am occupational therapy lead for children and young people in Lanarkshire, but today I am representing the Royal College of Occupational Therapists. So I echo pretty much what everybody else has already said, but I suppose the key things from an occupational therapy point of view is we've all experienced the loss of our roles over the last year in our occupations, and I think that's the key thing. We've lost our routines, our activities, things that we take for granted, and that no more so than for our children. They've lost access to education, the opportunity to play, to meet, socialise and learn the things that they need to progress through life. think from an occupational therapy point of view, the children that we already support are the children who have a level of need with a range of disabilities, life-limiting conditions, developmental needs, autism. The range is vast, so there are already children who have a level of need, and this has been compounded by the COVID pandemic. We know that children thrive on a stable start. We know the issues that around poverty, poor housing, lack of education, and the lack of support that education gives young people and their families, the routine of getting up every day and going to school. We want the children and young people to have access to play. Play is a main occupation of children and young people. Access to green spaces, outdoor activities, leisure facilities, everything that has been stopped. But there was already issues before the pandemic for children accessing some of these as a result of some of the poverty issues, access, travel. So it has been compounded. I suppose one of the key things for us in the NHS is the threat of the redeployment. We are beginning to see the significant fallout of the children who services were stopped when all their services were suspended, and staff across the whole of occupational therapy were redeployed into acute sites, which was what was essential. But we need to prioritise the needs of our children and young people going forward. We are seeing the evidence of developmental delays, children who didn't have good nursery time and now they're already in school and they've lost that opportunity to develop those early social skills. We need to make sure that we're supporting the parents around these children. We work very hard to empower parents to self-manage and support the children the best they can. But that's very difficult when, as we've all said, these parents are struggling. These parents are struggling with their activities, their routine, levels of stress, levels of anxiety, poverty. So I think that probably covers everything from an occupational therapy point of view that's not really been covered already this morning. So thank you.
Thank you very much to all of you for giving us that overview. Sue, you've put an R in the chat box. Are you wanting a supplementary on any particular point, or do you want to?
Yes, it's directed to Jackie Pepper. You spoke at length about some of the drug and alcohol issues that parents may have impacting directly on the children. And I suppose I'm wanting to ask about, to what extent are you getting a sense that young people are at risk of more adverse childhood experiences, or have been, whether it be abuse or physical abuse or any sort of adverse childhood experience?
Thank you very much for that question. Again, this is a topic we could probably spend the whole session on, I think. can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah. I think one of the things, just to look at trends and patterns, and it might be helpful for the committee to be aware of this, that what we saw across Scotland in the first 6 months of the pandemic was actually, or probably into the first 9-12 months, a higher referral rate into social work services. So, you know, once universal services started to return, once families were being seen, we were seeing many more concerns being referred to social work services in the first instance, primarily from education and police services. So that will give you an indication of what's been happening there. And I don't think we've seen that go down. So that is continuing. What that hasn't necessarily done is worked all the way through the systems to mean that more children are being registered in the Child Protection Register, but it's meant much more activity at that investigatory stage, and in terms of ensuring that all services are working around families and as best as they possibly can to provide the intervention that's required to ensure that these children don't end up within the child protection or the statutory system in terms of care. So and from my own perspective, the vast majority of these children will be affected to some degree by parental mental ill health, parental substance misuse, and domestic violence, and those three feature significantly in the lives of those children. And I think because you know, families have been less visible for a period of time, it's very difficult to quantify what that has meant, but certainly there are significant features, and I think it's certainly an area for inquiry for the committee to look at in a bit more depth. And I'm happy to see what I can do in the future to provide a bit more information for you. Thanks.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you. Sue, could you want to lead on our theme around person-centred services, if you want to continue then.
Thank you, convener. Yes, we've heard a lot from most of you around today about the whole family approach that's needed. And in our session before this, we spoke with Audit Scotland that held NHS Ayrshire and Arran up as a beacon of good practice. So I suppose the professor first I can ask is, so how could services be organised to provide a more joined up experience for children and young people? And are you able to give any examples? I suppose that's relevant to anyone that's here today. But can we start perhaps with Professor Borland?
Thank you very much for that, and no pressure. I think that I would absolutely be proud of the work that's happening right across Ayrshire and Arran, across our whole system. From a children's services perspective, we work in an incredibly integrated way. So the relationships that we've got between health and social care and with our other multi-agency partners, such as Police Scotland, are very, very strong. So that has given us an incredibly strong foundation. We are really keen to support the voices of children and young people, and the enshrinement of the United Nations Rights of the Child has really given us a basis for that to build on, and we welcome that. We've established a strategic corporate parenting group that works really closely with the corporate parenting agencies and groups across our local authorities. And obviously, we've taken very strong account of the promise, and we have developed a corporate parenting promise that takes us from 2021 into 2024. And we've got a dedicated work stream as part of that promise, which aims to ensure participation and consultation, for example, with our care experienced population of children and young people in an ongoing and systematic way rather than ad hoc one-off elements. We really want that to be a systematic approach. Our public health teams have aimed to undertake some bespoke local research so that we can inform our needs assessment, and again working really closely with our local authorities. Our three local authorities have got incredibly mature mechanisms for getting the voice of children and young people heard, and so working across those has been incredibly beneficial. And so we're working with their champions boards, we're connecting closely with our CAMS colleagues, as you would imagine, and it means that what we've been able to do is come up with our corporate parenting action plan that sits underneath our parenting promise, that is enabling us really now to think about, so from 2022 onwards, what are our priorities, focusing, I guess, on the pandemic as well, in terms of, as colleagues have described, really sharpening the focus. Some of the things that we're aware of are not new. Colleagues have described that as well, the things we were already aware of, but the pandemic has absolutely highlighted them, escalated a number. One of the other things that we're going to be paying close attention to is a piece of work that I'm not sure if the committee are aware of. So there is a National Children and Young People Service Improvement Group that is run through the Scottish Public Health Network, part of Public Health Scotland, and they have started through 2021 to undertake a piece of work that will result in a paper entitled Ensuring Our Future, Addressing the Impact of COVID-19 on Children and Young People and Their Families. I would commend that piece of work to the committee once it's been completed. I'm not sure of the publication date and when that will be finished, but I think that's going to prove incredibly valuable. We're also aiming to focus on a whole family approach, as other colleagues have described. It's impossible to look at children and young people in isolation. Colleagues with more experience than I have described the importance of the impact of parental mental health on children and young people, parental stress and distress, And really how we need to make sure that we are supporting families. Mm-hmm. That then brings us back to poverty and how we do that. So that absolutely is one of our foundational approaches in terms of supporting whole families, and then gradually beginning to unpick that for any bespoke needs assessment that we may need to target particular interventions at. I'm hoping that that's helpful. Mm-hmm.
Yes, sorry, thank you. I don't know if anyone else wants to
just that. a reminder to our panellists, if you want to come in on anything there, just to use the chat box. I see Jackie Pepper wants to come in. Jackie.
Thank you very much. Just to say that I would agree with Professor Borland and everything that she's said there. I think what's key is to ensure that an integrated approach is taken, and that services are working together. And in terms of some of the examples that you asked for, from a Perth and Kinross perspective, I would like to highlight the work of our youth services, because we have an integrated youth service which works alongside social workers and others, and very much provides that holistic support for young people, irrespective of your circumstances, and much more in a targeted way. But that's low-key, non-stigmatised. You can walk in off the street and you can speak to somebody and you can and receive support there. And that has been absolutely invaluable throughout the whole pandemic, and is something that we would certainly be wanting to hold on to. So it's that kind of integrated, holistic support, not just for young people, but also for families too. And one of the other pieces of work that we're doing is that we are working around along with the Wellbeing Economy Alliance, which is a global initiative, and working along with partners to test out the Wellbeing Economy Alliance design guide, which is about designing for or budgeting for wellbeing. And the piece of work that we're doing in Perth is actually engaging with families about what works for them. And I think Professor Borland was very articulate in saying this is about what works for families. And some of that is actually pretty, it's not new, it's what we know what's best for families. And I'm sure others will articulate that too. And in that, if you speak to families and speak to children, it's very much about what is in around their community and what supports them in a holistic way in their community. So we must make sure that these are easily accessible in your street, in your neighbourhood, and have a locality focus, and that they're easily accessible. So it's about that wrapping around families and providing that holistic family support.
Can I come to Heather Connolly then?
Yeah, so I would echo what my colleagues have kind of said, that I think that kind of whole systems approach, whole family approach, is really, really important. And it looks great on paper, but how's that embedded in actual services, and what does that look like? And what are some of the barriers to actually doing that and having that multi-agency interconnectedness? And I think for delivering person-centred care just now, our workforce are the complete stress and burden and burnout and moral injury of our workforce will impact on their ability to be able to deliver person-centred care. You know, one of the cornerstones of person-centred care is delivering services with compassion. But actually, if our workforce have no compassion for themselves just now, because they're working under extreme stress, extreme burnout, then we're going to have really difficulty in delivering a person-centred service. So I think when we're thinking about the whole service and holistically, we also need to think about the workforce that are delivering that and how we can support the workforce to be able to have the effective skills and techniques and support to be able to deliver a person-centred service.
Thank you. And Mary Glasgow?
Thank you. Yes, just building on that theme around person-centred planning out experience, and is very much informed by the children, young people and families that we support, is that pre-pandemic and made worse during the pandemic, many of our systems, many of our support services, complicated to understand if you're a family member trying to reach out and engage with them. We use professional language, which is often very, very heavily weighted toward jargon that we understand. We can often design processes and systems that without intent actually feel quite stigmatising or blame and shame inducing. And whilst nobody intends that, we hear really strongly from families that one of the key things that person-centred, that good person-centred services would offer would be more time. Heard there from Heather about compassion, more space, more time to really get to know children and young people, to get to know families, to listen to their stories from their perspective, to really have the space and time to understand what is it that's led to this current difficulty and how might we start where the family is rather than what the professional or agency can spare to offer. And one of the things that we talked about, which was really heartening at the beginning of the pandemic, was that we needed to review our systems and we needed to make them much more human and much more person-centred, much more getting alongside, being with, rather than doing to people. And I think that's a theme that we may be losing if we're not careful. We need to hold on to that original intent. And if I could just highlight one example that we've worked with alongside our health and social care partnership, in fact, in two health and care social partnerships, designing and developing multi-agency family wellbeing teams, where in response to, and this was pre-pandemic, we began to test out this model, in response to that concern that many parents, carers, children and young people had, that when they presented at universal services like GP, which is often the first point of contact, with concerns and anxiety about children's wellbeing, about really significant worries about anxiety, about eating disorders or self-harming, they were often met with a response from their GP, which was, you know, that the roots of their concern could really only, or their needs could really only be met through CAMHS and through very clinical-based services, and there were long waiting times for that. At Children First, we've heard and we've designed services and learned from those services that often what's required are whole family support services. You've heard a lot about that this morning, where when we really listen to what's going on, many children are distressed, not because they have clinical difficulties, a small number do, or a medical need, but often because social and family relationships are fractured and under pressure, as we've heard. And children often carry that weight of worry, anxiety and concern, and it manifests itself in all the ways that we've heard about. So they become withdrawn, stop eating, they stop going to school, they become very anxious. And what we designed was a service that offered very quick, early help and preventative support to children and families, so where the GP can refer directly into our wellbeing team, and we made a commitment to make contact with the parent, carer and family within 2 weeks. And what we've offered is a whole family support response, which has led to children not being needed to be assessed by CAMHS. It's led to parents and carers feeling much more confident because they've got support, they feel heard, they've got somebody that they can talk through that's skilled in understanding the impact of poverty, adverse childhood experiences, trauma, and take a very recovery-focused and social approach to that. And we've seen that that can have a real impact. But one of the challenges that we've got is these test, learn, develop initiatives that can produce good evidence are really difficult to take to scale because of a lack of funding. Funding is very short term. And we really need to fill that gap between universal services and very specialist services like CAMHS. And what we need to fill that gap with is that whole family support, community-based offer that any parent or carer without stigma or shame can reach out, access quickly and get the support they need. Because many parents talk to us about feeling that they're funneled through a process and a system where they're often offered labels and diagnostics for their children, but they're very rarely offered practical or strategic help to overcome some of those difficulties. So many children and families go through that process and have a whole myriad of labels for their children, but they're not left with long-term support to help them manage that and recover from that. So I think person-centred themes are really important. When we need to humanise systems, we need to put children and families' needs at the centre, we need to build in time, and we need to allow really skilled professionals the space and time to build relationships so that they can really focus on long-term recovery and improvement for children and families, rather than short-time dealing with waiting lists, seeing people getting them off. And then, because what we know is it just becomes a revolving door, they just represent again if we don't actually get to the heart of the matter and really address what's going on. So there's a need for investment right across the board that's consistently applied in Scotland for early help and prevention through family support, that supports the whole family to understand what's happened and help to recover from that. Thank you.
I'm going to move on to Kirsty Louise, and just to let everyone know that we've got a number of themes to get through. We've got a number of committee members wanting to delve into detail. I know there's an awful lot for us to cover in this session. I'll come to Kirsty Louise and then to Suzanne.
Absolutely. I think there's so much. We could probably be here all day talking, but I'll be very brief. I wanted to just really highlight that point again around the need for space and time, I think, for practitioners, and actually for that's what families tell us that they want as well. Family support is about actually getting alongside those families and building up those relationships. And I think it's really just worth highlighting sometimes the challenges with making sure it is a person-centred service when there is pressures on funding, short-term funding, or that insecurity, you know, looking towards, you know, the next year, that can be a real challenge. And I think that's something that could be improved. And I think that, yeah, I would echo the comments made by Jackie and by others as well around the need for actually really co-creating change with families, and also just keeping in mind the importance of the promise as well, and making sure that the voices of children, young people and families is central to what we're doing.
Thank you. And can I come to Suzanne?
Thank you, Convener. I'll be brief as well. It was just really to echo some of what was said, obviously, that a child and a young person doesn't function without a family or a support mechanism around them. And I suppose it's, from an occupational therapy point of view, it's what can the family manage? Obviously, what we do is offer a kind of practical solution to what would be a challenge for some of the young people. I think there's lots of talking to the young people, as Mary Glasgow suggested, around some of the kind of wellbeing issues that would routinely be referred through CAMHS, but I think from that kind of occupational therapy focus, it's like, how do we return some of these children, for example, to school? We're able to offer that level of support. What can the family manage? How can we support these young people to get back to school? And as an occupational therapist, that's something that we would do. You get them to school every day, you put that support in place until the parents and the young person are able to manage that on their own. And I think by working in that kind of graded way, analysing where the challenges are, it gives parents and the carers around the young people that kind of mechanism to look at the next challenge and how do we break that down? How do we break that task down to make it more manageable for these young people? Thank you.
Thank you. Now, Standish, you wanted to ask Mary Glasgow a quick question before I move on?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, it was just a specific question to Mary Glasgow. So I couldn't agree more about the filling the gap between the universal specialist care. But GPs like me struggle to know all the organisations that we have for all the different specialist cares and issues we have. So my question really is, how can we ensure that people in primary care, health visitors, anyone who can refer to you, actually know that organisations that do work like yourself exist? So that we can actually access it.
Haley.
Thank you very much for the question. It's a really good one. I think the first point is that there aren't enough of those services. So whilst we have two or three whole family wellbeing services across Scotland, they're not enough. So we are often contacted by families in other areas who will say, particularly through our parent line service, which is an online phone support and digital service, we get many calls from very distressed and anxious parents saying, I've been to the GP, but the GP doesn't have anywhere to refer me. Do you have services that can support families like ours? And whilst we can offer that type of emotional support over the phone or online, we don't have services in every community across Scotland. So first of all, we need to make sure that those preventative, first step, early help family support services exist. And we obviously welcome the government's plan to invest in whole family support, but it needs to be universally applied right across the country. And where we do exist, organisations like mine do work really closely with partnerships so that we co-create them with families, that we work alongside schools, and that we work alongside universal services, so that professionals like GPs and health visitors are very aware of them. And so the onus is on us to make sure that we co-create those and that we talk about them, that we publicise them, and that we make sure that they exist. In one of our services, for example, in East Renfrewshire, we are linked to every GP practice across that area, and we've spent a long time getting to know and building relationships with GPs. And I guess from an organisation like our perspective, where we take a social approach to our work with families, reassuring that colleagues from the medical profession that for some families, social support is what's required, that not all of those children require clinical interventions. But one of the challenges that we've got is we design those services usually through very short-term funding that we manage to support and that we manage to access, from trusts and foundations, test, learn and develop new ideas, new innovations, and then we are, you know, dependent on making sure that we can evidence that they make a difference, and then engage with our HSCP partners, try and get much needed funding to take them to scale and to sustain them over time. This is not short term work. So I know the question was about making sure that colleagues and other agencies know about services. The truth is there are far too few of them, so they don't exist. That's why you don't know about them. The first thing we need to do is scale up those innovations that have made a real difference. And the second thing is really engage with families, communities and local agencies to make sure that you do know where they are and how to access them, and that they're built jointly together. Hope that's answered your question.
Colleagues, we're going to have to move on, and I'm sorry I'm not able to really allow colleagues to come back in with supplementaries when, I mean, we really are prioritising this fantastic evidence from our panellists to give them more time to tell us their views. Can I move on to talking about stigma? Emma Harper, you have a question, and if you can direct them as much as possible, and panellists commit, put an R in the chat box if you have something to add.
Thanks, convener. Good morning to everybody. Yes, I do have a couple of questions about stigma, and it was one of the things that Professor Hazel Borland mentioned right at the beginning in your opening comments, and it's nice to see you here this morning, Hazel. So a couple of questions about stigma. One of the examples in our paper, in our papers, was a summary from The Promise in August 2020, and it talks about the language that we use and how we need to not use stigmatising language, and there's specific examples around not showing up in uniforms, lanyards or branded cars outside people's homes or schools. So that's a couple of examples, but I'm wondering, Professor Borland, if you can talk a little bit about what actions could or should be taken to continue tackling stigma so that families feel confident that they don't experience stigma when they're accessing help.
Thanks very much, Emma, and it is lovely to see you too. I think we would agree locally that it can feel like we're at the very beginning of this journey in terms of trying to rectify and turn this stigma issue around. One of the things that we need to look at is our use of language. It's one of a portfolio of issues tackling stigma. And so we're recognising that that narrative that surrounds care and care experienced young people, for example, can be incredibly negative and at times then impact on the improved outcomes that we want to achieve for children and young people, and how they connect with their support network and their families. We are aiming to use the Each and Every Child toolkit in order to turn that around, and we're at the beginning of rolling that out. It's not happened in the way that we would have liked because of the impact of the pandemic and the need to reprioritise some of our universal services at this point, but definitely that Each and Every Child toolkit is going to be instrumental in how we report the difference that we feel we're going to be able to make. We are
focused very closely on the promise and our actions that sit underneath that. We're keen to make Esher and Arran the best place in Scotland to grow up. And so that's about working really closely across health inequalities. One of the topics that we've touched on throughout this meeting so far has been poverty. Poverty is incredibly stigmatising for families because it reduces choice, it reduces your options, it means you can't say yes to things that you might want to say yes to as a child, a young person or a family. And so it means that your world becomes much narrower, and that can then ultimately create an incredible stigma around you and how you feel about yourself, as well as how others perceive you. So how we tackle poverty collectively is going to be incredibly important. And while each local authority and each NHS board and health and social care partnership will do what they can locally, then I think we would all agree that there's definitely a national focus that's needed in that area. And how we also approach care experience and care experienced young people, how we hear their voices, how we understand what their needs are, how we work with those champions boards, how we try to reduce the number of children and young people that need to be taken away from their own place of living to get that care. That's also incredibly stigmatising, impacts on a children and young person's mental health, which then impacts on their physical health as well. So I feel that we are not as far along the reducing stigma journey as we would like to be. And for me, that's the impact of the pandemic and some of the activity we've had to prioritise, but we're firmly focused on it. Probably because we are now seeing the impact of the pandemic on all these things as well. And it's really made it even more important that we aim to prioritise it. So I hope that's helped, Emma.
Emma, can I bring in Heather Connolly and Kirsty Louise want to come in on that? So I'll bring in Heather.
Sure, thanks. Thanks, convener. I'll just reiterate Professor Boland, I think language is so important, and the language they use. And I think, again, when we're thinking about multi-agency whole systems approach, we all need to be using the same language and how we engage children and young people within the services to reduce that stigmatisation. And I think completely right, as Professor Boland has said there, that if children and young people feel that stigmatisation, that impacts on kind of their basic needs, again, about feeling safe and feeling secure. And if we lose those basic psychological principles, then we're going to find it really, really hard to try to engage people again in services. And I think going back to an earlier point as well about sometimes we can over pathologise and over diagnose people and children and young people and families, when actually often it's just normal human responses to things such as poverty and things like that. So I think it's just being aware of how we interact and engage with people within the services is really, really important to try to reduce the stigmatisation that people feel that's there. And again, that links into the person-centred support and care and services. That if we have services that are much more person-centred, allowing people to tell their story and their narrative, really listening to them, validating them that you know, life is horrendous and you've got so much difficulties, and try not to over-pathologise somebody into mental health, mental distress, but actually listening and engaging them through that way can be so, so important to trying to reduce that stigma as well.
Thank you. Can I come to Kirsty Louise?
Yeah, thank you. I think it's a really, really important point that's been raised, particularly around language. What I think we would really like to see is actually a truly trauma-informed approach embedded throughout services, which are supporting children and young people, particularly in education settings. Bernardo Scotland, we had teamed up with Public Health Scotland a couple of years ago, just before the pandemic, actually. To actually work on a video which kind of asked education staff their views about kind of practical examples and tips that they could use for talking just generally about wellbeing and mental health and within a setting where people feel comfortable and that they're not being sort of, you know, put in a tick box or kind of, as Heather Connolly had said, sort of pathologised or kind of sectioned off into, oh, you have got this particular issue and therefore it's this particular service. We actually need to be I think just seeing the whole person, I could just highlight one example, if I could, of one of our family support services. Our nurture service in Inverclyde has basically, it's a no wrong door approach. The type of service we have in that is to provide holistic support, which is non-stigmatising, and actually see the whole person. So it provides support from pre-birth right up to the age of 18, and supports parents and families too. But the idea behind that, I think as well, which is so important for, I think, tackling stigma, is that it's not about, you know, if someone feels stigma around, you know, they can't afford to feed themselves because they've got their gas bills to pay and their uniforms to buy for their children. It's not about saying, well, that's the one particular issue, we're only going to look at you for that particular issue, or single that family out. It's actually about seeing that family and that person as a whole person, and not stigmatising them by sort of like siloing them off, I suppose, is what I'm trying to get across. The approach that we take in that service is that it's holistic, and they will receive the help and support in that relational aspect, however they need it, and for however long they need it, and what we kind of want to see with that, as well as the ability for that to be scaled up, because unfortunately as well, we have, similar to Mary Glasgow's comments, there will be family support services in certain areas, but unfortunately, you know, that's not available to everyone on a kind of universal equal basis across the country. So that's the type of approach that we think would really help, I think, in tackling poor mental health and wellbeing.
That's great to hear, and that whole issue of the no wrong door takes an awful lot for somebody to go through a door in the first place. And yeah, thank you. Can I come to Mary Glasgow?
Thank you. Yeah, just a few points on this, because it's such an important issue. One of the things that children, young people and parents talk to us about is the labels that they're given by different agencies. So parents will say, you know, if I go to the GP or the health service, I'm a patient. If I go to other services, I can be a service user, or sometimes I'm just called mum. What they describe is feeling quite dehumanised by that, not seen as an individual and a person. There are really simple things about language. I say it's simple, I know it's not simple. We're in the middle of trying to redesign our platform for hosting information and measuring the difference that we make with families. And we're paying really careful regard to the language that we use. We are so used in our systems using language that other people don't understand. What does it mean to be referred and assessed and reviewed? This is not human language. It doesn't imply that people have agency within their own stories. So we need to start thinking about using much more humanised, kind and compassionate language, and really think about access to support and access to services as a right. Because if you take a rights-based approach and say to people, you are entitled to get support with some of these really complicated and understandable difficulties that are beyond your control, you remove stigma. Much of what we deal with the children and families that we support is time spent overcoming the shame and guilt that they feel at needing to get help. All of us who are parents will recognise this feeling. When your child is not doing well, when you have a child who's anxious or distressed or not coping, first port of call tends to be, what did I do wrong? What did I not do? And parents carry that shame. And sometimes inadvertently, without intent, our systems and our agencies and even our professionals can reinforce that because of the language that we use, because we're under pressure, because we don't take the time to really listen and reassure people. And the last thing I wanted to say is, one of the biggest things that we see that has the really significant impact is when you say to children and young people, and even parents and carers, no wonder why you feel like this. There's nothing wrong with you. This is an entirely appropriate and understandable response for some really stressful and difficult circumstances. There is nothing inherently wrong. It's absolutely okay to express emotion, to have distress and anxiety. And one of the things we need to get better at with children and young people from the minute they're born, from the minute we engage with parents and carers, is to help people name and share the feelings that we've got. Because we know that when you can help children say out loud what it is that they feel, they automatically feel slightly better, and then you can begin to move on from that. So shame, stigma, guilt needs to be removed, and I really echo the point about learning and development opportunities for professionals and helping staff. One of the first things that we need to do is think about how do we feel and think about the people that we support. We need to stop othering people and get right alongside them and imagine that they need and want the same level of respect, engagement, kindness and compassion as we. And one of the biggest things we know is a barrier to help is that feeling that you're made to feel that there's something wrong with you or that you've done something wrong. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I come to Jackie, and then I'll move on to a question from Carol Mockin. Jackie.
I was just going to very, very briefly, because I'm aware of the time constraints that you're working to, but it was really just on the point of stigma, thinking from a social work perspective, that very complex landscape that we're talking about, that this is that entire continuum of support and protection from very early intervention through to what is the management of complex risk and statutory intervention and the removal of children from their birth families. And just to recognise that stigma has a place in there too. Just echoing what Mary was saying, that becoming a parent or a carer is one of the most difficult things that you can ever do. And just the recognition of that. So it's that empathy with parents and empathy with the family, but recognition, that continuum of support right through the system is required. And how do we ensure that we have strong, trusting relationships throughout that process? Because it's the relationships that with families that are key to that. Thank you.
Thank you. Carol, can I come to you to talk about health inequalities, Carol?
Great, lovely. Thank you so much. Thank you to all the panel for coming along. And I think a lot of what has already been discussed talks about things that need to be done and support that needs to be given in terms of inequalities and prevention. There's a couple of things I wanted to just pick up on. And some of the evidence we got from young people, they spoke about the sort of lots of support available when they're in crisis, but in that journey and that way towards crisis, there's not so much support available. And I wondered what the panel thought about that, if they had experienced that, and if there is some way of looking at that. Just in terms of time, I'll maybe go on and say I'm also interested to hear from the panel. We've talked a lot about poverty and how we look at that, and sort of family, whole family approach, which is is something I've heard before. Just a wee bit more information on that. We talk a lot in government about investment and funding and finances, and I'm sure people have views on what we need to do there, but also what things do we need to do differently that is not just about the financial provision? And I wondered if members could give a wee bit of feedback on that as well, please.
Thank you. And is there anyone you'd like to pose that to, first of all, to allow a lot in there?
I wondered, particularly maybe Kirsty Louise, around sort of, before young people are in crisis, what kind of things do people say they need?
Kirsty Louise?
Yeah, again, it's a really important issue. I think that's something that we hear quite a lot, I think, from young people and the Bernard of Scotland staff that are supporting them. It's actually about the tiers almost maybe before you would get to that sort of crisis intervention level that we need to see support available. What we'd kind of found from recent engagement in the survey of even school-based staff that I talked about, kind of really clear feedback that came through that in terms of what's needed is more investment or better resourcing of the early intervention. So when Carol, you kind of also asked about that kind of whole family approach. I think when we were talking about holistic family support, for example, you know, Barnardo Scotland has family support workers who are based in schools. So it's that sort of approach where we're taking a wraparound approach to be, we want to be where children and families actually are. It's not necessarily about saying someone goes to their GP and then, you know, they maybe are referred and it feels maybe quite clinical or something that's not actually rooted in their own lives. So what we are kind of wanting to get with that is actually investment and supports at that early intervention level so that issues and problems don't escalate perhaps to a stage where we need more crisis intervention. Obviously we welcome the Scottish Government's plan for the Whole Family Wellbeing Fund over the course of this Parliament, but what we really want to see in Barnardo Scotland is a kind of urgent action plan as to how that funding can get to frontline services and actually deliver that scaling up of intervention that we want to see. So I think, has been mentioned before by other colleagues, when we're talking about approaches and maybe how best to support families, there's probably a lot of agreement and families themselves tell us what they need. So I don't think it's an issue of that we don't know what works. I think it's an issue actually about then what action can we take, particularly in light of the impact that the pandemic has had and how we respond to that to make sure that, you know, as we, you know, continue to go through the pandemic, as we look towards, you know, the rest of this decade and how then exactly we fulfil our promise that was made to children and young people as well. It has to be focused on the actions that are needed to make sure that that infrastructure, that scaffolding that the promise talks about is there so that that you know, people that support children and young people are properly supported to do that. I'm conscious of time as well, but hopefully that answers some of what you were getting at.
Thank you. Can I come to Suzanne?
Thank you, Carol. In AHP land in Scotland, we work under Ready to Act, which is this sort of transformational plan that out by the Scottish Government in 2016. So part of that is about looking at children and young people accessing services at the right time, in the right place, and the right opportunities for them. And within that, it's a much more tiered approach to services. So we have universal, targeted, and specialist. So I think that's where we can look at that early intervention and prevention before the families and the children and young people reach that crisis point. So in thinking about some of the universal services, we are able to offer some parent workshops that parents can tap into that works across Scotland. We each have different workshops that we might offer. So some of the kind of common difficulties that children and families might experience, we feel if parents can access that quickly, it doesn't have to be a referral, as Mary Glasgow was talking about. The new language now is a request for assistance. And how is that assistance going to look for families? We've also got the opportunity to work within schools and education without having that formal paperwork for children and young people, supporting staff within these education establishments to provide the interventions with the support of all the allied health professionals. But obviously I'm talking about occupational therapy today. So I think that's kind of one of the ways that we can begin to put supports in place before the children and young people reach a crisis point. Staff are more aware, parents are more aware, and I think it's also building that relationship so that they do have a relationship with the professionals around them that are there to support before they reach that crisis point, and they've got a sort of direct access there. They know who they're going to come to talk to for that support and hopefully prevent the crisis, you know, and really kind of support the long-term wellbeing of the children and young people. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Suzanne. Can I come to Heather?
And thinking about kind of health psychology and how our services can become a wee bit more psychologically informed in terms of how we support engagement at this early intervention, prevention is so, so important. We know that, otherwise a downward spiral happens and that makes it 10 times more difficult to engage people and support people at that kind of lower tiered levels. And I think if we need to make sure that we're meeting people's basic needs and basic psychological needs before we can think about any other services that are there. And I think we also need to think about a health promoting environment. So people don't don't live in a vacuum. Children don't live in a vacuum. Once they've spoken to somebody, they might have had a fantastic, lovely, compassionate conversation, but they're still going back out into that world, which might be hitting them with stigma and discrimination and inequalities. So it is that whole systems approach about how we support people. And if we're a little bit more psychologically informed, that whole system about how we engage people, how we can support behaviour change, how the system can change itself, because it's a massive system we're talking about. And that in itself is really, really complex to support the system to change and adapt to meet the needs of children and young people at an early intervention prevention level. Because if we can get them at that point, I think it was Mary that said earlier, often we see a revolving door if we capture people too late in the distress or the difficulties that they're experiencing. So I think it's important what everybody said, and again, I'm aware of time, so I won't talk too much.
Thank you. Can I come to Jackie?
Thank you very much. What a great question about what more can we do around that earlier intervention and avoid the crisis. And could I just, if I may, give two practical examples of that. And I'm thinking that of a piece of work where it was a transformational service redesign, which was moving away from providing residential care for young people who couldn't be held within the family or within their own communities, but redesigning that to create a team of providing intensive family support for teenagers, so 12 to 18, and that was provided in a way that's actually 24/7. But primarily in evenings and weekends. So it's about providing that support when families most need it, when young people most need it. So I think that's a practical example of about thinking what more do we need to do, and not necessarily to continuing to provide things in traditional ways. If we really are listening to families, both in what they tell us and how their needs are presenting, we need to design our services in a way which actually best meets their needs and doesn't just continue to provide it in a traditional way. And secondly, I mentioned about the increase in concerns that has come about as a result of the pandemic. And a small example there would be providing immediate access to family support workers, so family and parenting support within the family home, through the, what would be the child protection and duty team. So for those families where it was relevant, referring them on to a family worker. So that all that required was two part-time workers working with 30 families who would have otherwise have gone through a whole kind of risk assessment and through the child protection procedures. And only one of the 30 of those families has moved on into a referral to the reporter. So I think that gives you a sense of the scale and value of putting, you know, one family support worker into that high-end crisis intervention and what that can actually result in. So it's really just some examples of what more can be done, and thinking about what works with families and where we need to perhaps put additional resource in. Thank you.
Thank you, Jackie. Can I come to Mary?
Thanks very much. Briefly, just wanted to make a couple of points about, I think the case about the links between poverty and health inequality are well made, that we haven't made the shift to prevention that we should have, and that we really need to think seriously about, you know, as far back as the Christie Commission, we were identifying then that we needed to shift away from crisis to really take a public health approach to make sure that we address the pillars of inequality, which are poverty, and often for many of the children that we support, the adverse childhood experiences that their parents and carers have experienced lead to stresses before they're even born, that without a focus on recovery just make things worse. We're also seeing particular concern about growing inequality for children and families where there are additional support needs like mental health, disability, particularly for Black children, families of colour, where there needs to be better representation and understanding of their needs, and there needs to be better connection to their communities about their specific wants and wishes in relation to the type of support that they have. So we know in Scotland we've got a growing diverse population, but we're not seeing that diversity always reflected in the way in which we're designing services. So I'd like to highlight in terms of inequality just a couple of those but specific needs, if I might. Thank you very much.
Thank you, that's very helpful. Carol, I'm sorry I have to move on, but thank you for rolling all your themes into one question. Very, very helpful. With that in mind, I'm going to move on to digging deeper into child poverty issues. Evelyn, you want to pick up on some of the things that have been mentioned around that? Evelyn Tweed.
Yeah, thanks, convener, and good morning, panel, and thanks for all your contributions so far. The Office for National Statistics said last week that the gap between the rich and the poor is the largest for more than a decade. We have an energy crisis, food prices are rising. What does this really mean for child poverty and for the health and well-being of our children? And could I pose that to Mary Glasgow, please?
Come to Mary first, then, Mary.
Yeah, thank you very much for that question. Incredibly important, and totally concur with that sense that child poverty is just growing beyond, you know, anything which we've ever seen before. It was a problem before the pandemic. The pandemic's exacerbated it. And quite simply, what we're seeing is that the impact on children and families is like nothing we've ever seen before. I've been a social worker for 30 years. I've never known children and families to be in such dire circumstances. They simply do not have enough money in their pockets to manage a decent standard of living. And we need to get money into the hands of children and families quickly. One of the things that we've seen over the pandemic was support from government direct to organisations like mine through an ability to give parents direct payments of cash. So quite often families are, you know, we've talked about that revolving door, the shame of poverty, the challenge in our system, the way in which social security is built, is so distressing, so difficult to navigate, that we see through our money wellbeing services that we provide, that very quickly our money advice workers who are trauma-informed and trauma-responsive can help families access huge amounts of benefit that they've not been entitled to, that they're entitled to, but not been able to claim because the system's just so complex. Literally hundreds of thousands of pounds worth of additional benefits going into the hands of families. And that is what makes the biggest difference, that families make really good parents and carers, despite the rhetoric that we often hear in the media, make really good choices about making sure that children are provided for when they've got money. So we've got to address child poverty in a sustainable way. It's getting worse. And the impact that it has is it causes terrible distress in parents and carers. And it impacts directly on the experiences and the opportunities that the children and young people who are living in poverty have. They do less well in school. Very difficult for children and young people to go to school and concentrate on learning if they've not had breakfast and they're worried about what they're going to eat when they're going home. That's it's very difficult for parents and carers to be available with all the warmth and love and support and care to give their children if they're actually really anxious about their ability to pay their utility bill, to buy enough food or to pay their rent. And these are really significant and growing concerns that we are seeing. So we need to make some, and obviously we welcome measures that have been taken, but they're simply not enough. And we also need to design a system which does not make families, children and families jump through all sorts of hoops to get access to money. We've been able to directly give payments to families to clear debt, which immediately reduces distress and puts more money in your pocket, to buy things like new fridges where there have been broken fridges, washing machines, to make sure that families have been able to put petrol in their cars to get to medical appointments. These are really significant things, but one of the challenges that we've got as an organisation is we have 5 money advice workers based within Children First Services. That's not enough. We need to have community-based, trauma-responsive, trauma-informed, well-trained money advice workers in every community right across Scotland to make sure that families can get the help that they need and can get the money that they're entitled to in their pockets as quickly as possible. But we also need to address the other issues around child poverty, which are complicated, we understand that, but we need to do much better, because the problem is definitely we are seeing beyond anything which we've experienced before, and it's a real concern, particularly this winter with the rhetoric around increased utility bills. We know that families are really, really worried about that.
Yeah, I'm just hearing this morning from my team that gas bills are going up by 500%. Yeah. That's shocking. And whatever government's doing to mitigate, it won't be enough to cover an increase like that. Can I come to Heather?
You know, was thinking about, again, a kind of our basic needs need to be met for us to be able to have the flexibility and the space in our brain to be able to engage in other services. So if we don't actually target poverty and child poverty, then all the other money that we're spending on services and interventions and early interventions won't work as well, because people won't be able to engage in those services because they're still too worried about getting food on the table or worrying about how you're going to get clothes to get your kid to school. And we then don't have the ability to feel safe and secure and have a sense of hope that things are going to get better. So therefore, we're unlikely to engage in other services or with other professionals. So I think we really need to consider that, because there's no point in doing all the other interventions if we haven't got the cornerstone of trying to support to meet people's needs, basic needs and basic psychological needs for them to thrive and flourish.
Thank you. And can I come to Hazel?
Thank you, convener. Recognising that colleagues have articulated very, very well other points that I would have made. And in Ayrshire, the most recently published data says that we have nearly 16,500 children living in poverty. Two of our local authority areas are the second and fourth largest authorities with the largest child poverty rates. And it ranges across all three local authorities from just under 25% to just under 28%. So it's a significant issue. And the pandemic has impacted in an unprecedented way. Colleagues in public health have described COVID as a disease of deprivation and poverty, because if you were already on that journey and already in that sphere, then unfortunately COVID has absolutely exacerbated that beyond all belief. And prior to the COVID pandemic, child poverty levels were forecast to increase significantly, with relative poverty reaching 38% by 2027-28. So we've got a very short time frame to be able to make a difference to this, and the pandemic has really brought this into sharp focus, and our local authorities in Ayrshire and Arran are focused on it in the way that Mary has described, in terms of those community-based advisors working really closely with third sector colleagues, with families and across some of our localities, to really make sure that families and children and young people are accessing anything that can make their lives better and easier in the way that they should expect. This isn't a favour we're doing families, children and young people. This is what they should be able to expect in terms of having a standard of living that should be their right. And it's about taking that rights-based approach. So it is a significant worry.
Thank you. And can I come to Kirsty Louise go back to Evelyn for a very quick question? So Kirsty Louise.
Yep, thank you. I'm conscious of time, so I will be brief. I think others have articulated the points exceptionally well, and I would agree with everything that's been said by others. I just wanted to highlight a couple of quick examples. I suppose, because Evelyn's question was about actually what does it really mean for children, young people and families. Although it's not shocking to us, although it should be, there are many occasions where the parents, young mums who are within our service will, you know, say actually come into service and they've maybe not eaten the last few days because they just don't have the cash. So I think increasing incomes and measures to do that are very important.
But as others have mentioned before, actually that is crucial, and that's what underlies a lot of the other issues in terms of the stress that causes, and then the stress that puts in family relationships and the mental health problems that can be caused by that. And just the other point I wanted to highlight very briefly was a piece of research that Barnardo's Scotland had done with in partnership with the NSPCC, but it's actually pre-pandemic, and I think that's what's so concerning, because what we found in a survey of our family support services in 2019 was that over the decade since 2014, that basically the level of support had decreased while the level of need had increased. That poverty was a really core issue for families, that the level of destitution had increased. And actually what we're finding from our services and from the families that we work with, that the pandemic has just made that all the more acute. So I really just wanted to drive home, yeah, it is a core issue that affects the children and families that we work with.
Yeah. Thank you. Evelyn, quick question.
Thank you, convener. Thanks for your patience. One very quick one. I'm very conscious that we had the recent cut to universal credit, and I want to know, has that also exacerbated child poverty? And again, I would like to ask Mary Glasgow, please.
Thank you very much. Yes, absolutely it has. Anything that removes financial support to families who are already struggling has given, one, them a really clear message that their poverty isn't important, and two, has just made life a lot more difficult. So I would totally concur that we see, you know, so many of our families queuing up at food banks, waiting to get enough food to eat, coming to us through our parent line service, for example, which again is online and over the phone and accessible to any child or parent or carer across Scotland. We often receive calls from parents who are saying that they do not have any food in the cupboard, and we're able to then get vouchers or actually send out workers with bags of shopping. So absolutely it's made a huge and significant difference. And I think it wasn't just the material difference that it made and the amount of money that people have in their pockets. It was the message that it sent to children, young people and families about how society views their needs, and this increase in shame and guilt that if you're a family that is reliant on benefits or in need of extra support for often very complex reasons, that society takes a certain view of you. And the way it was withdrawn was very brutal and very unfair, and it's had a huge impact on the children and families that we support, not only practically and financially, but emotionally too, I think. I think children, the parents we support, are not immune. And all of this induces more shame, more guilt, more embarrassment, and more reluctance often ask for help. And we do see parents who regularly do not eat in order to feed their children, or do not have the money to buy basic things like children's coats, shoes, particularly in the cold weather. We're hearing a lot from families about their inability and reluctance to put the heating on because they are absolutely terrified about what's coming in terms of increased bills.
And from our perspective as the Health Committee, health outcomes suffer as a result of that. So that's very well made. Evelyn, I must move on and come to Sandesh Gohani. I know you're having problems with connection, so hopefully Sandesh is here, maybe audio only.
I hope I keep working. Thank you, convener. That we could spend the entire time we have on COVID-19 as a topic, and I know time is short. So, you know, at the start of the hearing, we heard about the loss of socialising for kids, the loss of the ability to make mistakes and errors as a child that we all have done, and we know that there's been a huge impact on all services. So what I would like to know, and I know it's going to be really hard to answer, but what impact on our young people's development and future development do you think COVID will have? And what should we do to mitigate this and set up services in future? So three questions. I suppose Heather Connolly and Jackie Pepper to start with, and then if anyone else wants to come in.
Go to Heather first.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Sandesh. I think, that the whole social connectedness has been lost for all of us, not just children and young people, but for all of us throughout this whole pandemic. but the impact that's had on children and young people from school closures, nursery closures, for their ability to learn those skills of how to make friends and deal with the difficulties that social interactions all bring to us, and how to manage that has been really tough and really difficult. I've got a 1-year-old and a 4-year-old through the pandemic, so I can see it in them as well, how much the impact of having that lack of social contact has had on them, just even from family, not just from friends, but lack of social contact from families. And I think, again, for the children and young people in society who have the most health inequalities, have the most poverty, this has been impacted harder on them about their lack of ability to engage and support that. And I think we're seeing delayed development, we're seeing delayed social skills, and how we combat that, I think, is again, like what we've all spoke about through the whole of this meeting this morning, is about understanding the whole system and how the whole system can approach and engage and interact with our children and young people to support and build those skills. We have a lot of work in the early intervention framework, which has a lot of interventions that are evidence-based and psychologically informed about how to support children in the early years to build on those skills and build confidence, build self-esteem. Again, these basic psychological principles that we need to grow and to flourish. So I think as services and as communities, we need to think about how we can engage with the people that the COVID-19 impact has impacted on the most in terms of those social skills. But also thinking about the whole system and our whole environment, about how we support that and how we become a wee bit more psychologically informed about actually how important just acceptance is, how important trust, how important just those normal relationships are and the impact that we have on them. We're humans and social and contact is so, so important to us. So again, I think as long as our systems and our interventions think about how we can build confidence, build self-esteem and build awareness of those emotional and psychological impacts that all of this has had on us, I think it would be beneficial.
Thank you, and I'll come to Suzanne.
Thank you. I think just as sort of Heather said there about the sort of social aspects, but from an occupational therapy point of view, what we are seeing is the physical impact on some of the activities that children have not been able to participate in. You've obviously got some of the kind of complex children, who are at risk of physical limitations, more kind of complex neurological conditions. But it's the children, it's the basic things of running around the gym hall and what that does for some of the young people. You know, where children are now back at education, and obviously that's been ongoing for quite a while. However, there's been small bubbles of children, you know, you're only mixing with 5 or 6, up to 10. But that whole running around the gym hall, what that does is one of the kind of simplest tasks in terms of thinking about your balance and coordination. Now, that seems quite simple, but you need your balance to get dressed. You need to be able to stand on one leg to put a sock on. You need to be able to stand on one leg to pull your trousers up. So the impact on that lack of physical development, we need to have that physical, that big gross motor movement, which then we develop to then refine into some of our finer skills. Children need to be able to handwrite. They need to be able to use cutlery. And as a developmental sequence, that's what you have to do. You do all these gross motor activities and that refines into some of the finer tasks. So I think the impact for some of our young children we're not seeing yet, and I think we will see that as we go further down the line. From our point of view, we see a lot of these children and we support them with their occupational therapy already, so that the children that we wouldn't normally come through our door or through our services, we're going to see more and more of these children coming through. They're going to come through with difficulties with their movement, their coordination, their handwriting, their activities of daily living, how they get dressed, how they access things. There's such a big impact, and that is just a small snapshot of the developmental concerns that I think have been and highlighted from that lockdown, lack of activity, lack of meeting, lack of going to school. So thank you.
Thank you. Can I come to you, Mary?
Thank you very much. I think one of the ways to look at this is, as people have said, is right the way through the developmental life course from pre-birth right up to adolescence and moving into young adulthood, children and young people have been hugely impacted So we hear of babies born during the pandemic who've only seen people or, you know, out and about with masks on, unable to read facial expression, not really knowing that, you know, other people are warm and friendly. So babies and toddlers reluctant to start to go to nursery or to begin to move through some of those social aspects that are so important because they've been so closely cared for by their own parents and carers at home. So I think that type of socialisation and ability to move through development stages, we're going to see impacts of that, I think, for a long time to come. We also know that the major issue for all of us, and particularly for children and young people, is one of loss. We've lost many normal opportunities to socialise, to be together, to develop and test our skills as humans, and we need to think about how we invest in a whole programme of activities, social, emotional and recovery focused activities where we spend time with children, with young people, with families, reflecting on what's happened, identifying what the impacts have been, and then working with them to think about what would help. I mean, from our perspective, particularly for some of the young people that we support, where families do live in poverty, we often do have, you know, they have very complex additional challenges like drug and alcohol use, like mental health problems that have been exacerbated, like family relationship problems that are challenging, domestic abuse. We need to think about a whole raft of supports that are available and easily accessible to help people really think about repair and recovery, not just from the pandemic, but from all of the challenges that they were already experiencing. Certainly one of the biggest concerns that we have as we move forward is that the ability for the country to be able to continue investment in those important services is a big worry. We are really worried and hearing some really worrying things about funding and about support services that were already underfunded, that were already limited, that were already hard to reach, being almost the first things that go. So we continue that cycle of investment in, you know, crisis intervention, because that feels like the most important thing. What we really need to do is think about prevention, and we need to think about repair and recovery for children and young people. We need to invest in youth work. We need to invest in making sure that every child and young person, regardless of their family circumstances or their economic situation, can access local community groups where they can join sports clubs, where they can go to scouts, where they can go to the Brownies, where they can do all of the things that help children and young people develop independence, the skills for adulthood, confidence, and all of the ways in which we operate as humans when it comes to getting jobs and, you know, making the country work. We really need to focus on repair, recovery, and a massive investment in social opportunities and activities to make sure that we help those children and young people feel less isolated and more connected to their peers and their communities.
Thank you. Can I come to Hazel? Just unmute you, Hazel. Broadcasting can just unmute Hazel, please.
Oh, thank you. Mary's just articulated it beautifully, I have to say, but in Ayrshire, we're particularly focused on the developmental delays in our infants. And just before the pandemic, data that we had from 2019-20 demonstrated that at the 27, 30-month reviews, 17% of those who had a review had a developmental delay in at least one of those domains. Now, there is no doubt, for all the reasons that colleagues have described, that those developmental delays across those domains will have increased. And so how we're going to need to be able to support that and make that better, we need to think about our universal services, being able to pick up those developmental delays, so our health visitors, our family nurses, and then we need to make sure that we've got the mechanisms by which to support the improvement of those developmental delays, which in the main is allied health professions. So speech and language therapy for children, occupational therapy for children, physio potentially for children and young people. That is going to be the way that we can influence that, because it's all very well identifying developmental delays, but you then need to be able to put the support in to help those delays be minimised and improve. So that probably would be the key point that I would want to make. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. And can I come to Jackie?
Thank you very much, Convener. In addressing the question about isolation and social connectedness, and I think we've all spoken about that, one of the things that was very much a focus from a social work perspective was to ensure that children, those children that were seen to be at risk and highly vulnerable, were seen face to face, and that was being measured by Scottish Government and Solus on a week to week basis. And I think our practice across Scotland has shown that through the lockdowns and restrictions that social workers in particular have made extreme efforts to see children face to face, using PPE within the family home, going out for walks, garden visits, all those kind of things. And actually relationships have been strengthened as a result of that. But it's those other opportunities that have been less available to children and young people as they move on into the independence and thinking about what that means for them. And that just to refer the committee to a number of pieces of research. Celsus did some work into the impact on children and families, and within that, the report it was indicating there that and some work from Who Cares as well, that although all that work was going on, 77% of care experienced children and young people that responded to a survey that was done were saying that they felt that they had received less support. And that included teachers and included lecturers, college lecturers, social workers, doctors, whatever that might be. But that was their experience. So we have to hear that very clearly. And that they describe feelings of worry and anxiety and vulnerability and depression and being tired. So that whole thing about being ready to move into group activity, take that up, is going to take some time. And I think that reflects also the comments previously made about what that means for the workforce. So giving time to the workforce, and that's across the whole children's services workforce in its broadest sense, to be able to spend with families, but to spend with young people, and really think what this means in the longer term to enable some of those young people who are furthest away from those universal supports and opportunities like Duke of Edinburgh, all those kind of things that are highly motivational and highly successful in ensuring young people achieve and move on in life, that longer term impact and the recovery from that. So how do we support the workforce, support some of these young people for longer to be able to recover and heal from the experiences that they've been receiving is a question for me.
Bandesh, very short question directed to one of our panellists, and I must move on, or else I'm going to disadvantage two of your colleagues.
Thank you, Convener. It's just coming straight back to Jackie, please. Teenagers, and when you're a teenager, you do silly things. We all have done it. We make little mistakes. We have errors, but that's where we learn. So when we become adults, we don't make those errors. Teenagers have lost that opportunity. What do you think that impact is going to be upon that age group?
I think one of the things that, just to reflect on what we saw as we moved into spring and summer last year, we were seeing young people beginning to gather and gather and get involved in what might be described as antisocial behaviour because of use of alcohol, etc., etc. So there's a real concern for me locally in Perth and Kinross, but nationally as well. What does that mean for young people's interaction and how they engage with each other, positively and meaningfully, and avoid those very difficult situations? So I think we saw that in some of the cities, but we saw that in our rural area, such as Perth and Kinross as well. And one of the things that we developed was a detached youth work team to actually go out and engage with young people on the streets or in parks or wherever they were engaging, because they were drinking, they were getting into difficulties as a result of that, but really trying to turn that around and provide some diversion and engage them in other activities, including physical activity such as football, etc., So I think those are the kind of things that, that we really need to think about. Young people who've perhaps been more distanced from some of those very positive experiences, ensuring that they're re-engaged in that and that they don't head off without that experience. I think that's what you're suggesting as well. So I think that there's ways in which that can be done, but I think my point about the workforce is that it's we're heavily dependent on the workforce to do all of this. And they are pressured, they are dealing with greater demands, and we are, you know, experiencing recruitment difficulties in certain areas as well.
Okay, thank you. We only have about 15 minutes left, and I have two themes that colleagues want to cover. So I'm going to ask for colleagues maybe not to follow up with a supplementary question, but to roll everything into one if you can. Can I come to David Torrance, who wants to ask a question around online content and social media?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to all the panel members. The length of time that young people spend on social media and the content that it could access, how is this affecting our health and wellbeing? Also, online bullying has a real impact on young people's mental health. Have we seen an increase during the pandemic? And what could the government and public services do to highlight the dangers of social media to young people?
Right, and maybe we want to go to Kirsty Louise
first, please.
Thank you. Kirsty Louise.
Thanks, David. Again, it's a really important question. In terms of, I suppose, specific data on whether there's been an increase in online bullying specifically, I don't have specific research or data on that to hand. But what I would say is, from the surveys that we've had back from staff in schools who work directly with young children, they have obviously reflected that, as would be expected, that there has been an increase in online activity during the pandemic because of that social isolation. Obviously, social media and online communication is a tool, and whilst there are definite, I suppose, issues where we want young people online to be safe, there can be positive aspects to it as well, in terms of that ability maybe to have a video call to keep in touch with their friends when they were obviously isolated during lockdown. Bernardo's, obviously, as a UK-wide organisation, does have some concerns about the forthcoming online safety bill, and we are looking for kind of further strengthened protections and safeguarding protections for young people in terms of accessing online harmful content and making sure that there's proper, robust age verification processes in place so that people, young people, don't access like age inappropriate material, and that actually, I think that there's lots the Scottish Government can do, I think, in terms of raising that awareness around internet safety and making sure that they're speaking to parents. I think what I would just also reflect as well is, in terms of that, especially the return to school, what our staff and the staff survey that we had reflected back to us was that they felt that young people now were spending more time online than they were pre-pandemic as well. And I think that that's something that probably needs more research in terms of that aspect that you brought up as to whether that is leading to other, you know, harmful impacts, maybe in terms of bullying. I think that it's obviously quite widely documented, whilst it can be, social media can obviously be a positive thing in terms of that peer pressure and perhaps other impacts of social media in terms of comparing yourself to others and, you know, social media filters and things like that. There's things there that we want young people to be aware, to be equipped with the knowledge, essentially, about, you know, what's, you know, kind of that differentiation between the real world and online as well. But hopefully that answers some of your questions, and I'd be happy to follow up again, I said, with some other with some of our other research and writing afterwards, if that would be helpful.
Yeah, that's always helpful if anyone wants to add anything afterwards to let us know in writing. Can I come to Suzanne?
Thank you for that question. I think social media has its place, and it gives children and young people the connection, and that is how they connect, that is how they communicate, and it's a fact of life. So I suppose it's about trying to make it safe for children and young people. We want to make sure the children and young people receive trusted and safe information, and I think that's where we have a responsibility as organisations. If somebody's asking us a question, we're able to provide up-to-date and relevant information. I think children, young people and their parents are less likely to go onto the kind of fast Google searches and trying and getting information that's not up-to-date in terms of social media and any thing that they want to ask. Across Scotland, we've looked at kind of creating bite-sized bits of information that parents and young people can access. So if you've got difficulties in one area, maybe it's how to reduce your anxiety, how to do your buttons, some of the kind of practical tasks. We've created small bite-sized videos that parents and young people can access. The hope is that if they can access the information quickly and timely in a place and a time that sort of suits them, it's whether they're less likely to go on and sort of look for other information. So I suppose it is about trying to make it safe for young people, trying to give them trusted sources, that is where they would access their information. But certainly there needs to be a bit more scrutiny on this, a bit in terms of sort of safety bill, looking at the real safety aspects around this for the children and young people. And I think really addressing the problems that young people have quickly, so that they're not then going and looking and getting information that's not up to date, it's not relevant, and it can be quite harmful.
Thank you. Can I come to Mary?
Thank you. Yeah. I think just building on that, and again, to say for many children and young people, the social media and the ability to connect online was a lifeline during the pandemic. It was the way they connected to each other. It was the way many of the children, or most of the children and young people that we were supporting, were able to connect with us. It was a way that we were able to keep eyes on children that we were really worried about during the early days of the pandemic. So it has its place and it's been really useful. And I think we've got to measure and balance what we're saying to children and young people about their social media in the context that we expected them to engage with online learning, we expected them to be on screens for many hours of the day, for lots of aspects of the pandemic for good reason. One of the things that we've got to do now is to wean them off a bit by giving them really exciting alternatives. Children and young people have nothing else to do. That's why they spend all their time on social media. And often the children that we support who live in poverty don't come from families where parents can pay for expensive activities to get them outside enjoying activities in the outdoors. So we really need to think about how we support children and young people to make better choices. I think we need to speak to help parents. We certainly see that in our whole family support work, where family relationships are breaking down, particularly between teenagers, but it's getting younger. I mean, most 8, 9, 10-year-olds have their own mobile phone now, their own iPads. What we are spend a lot of our time doing is negotiating between parents and children and young people about how do they talk about social media use and on-screen time without becoming an additional source and break, you know, reason to break the relationship. So we need to help parents find ways to talk about children and young people. But we all as adults need to model really much better behaviour ourselves on social media. We all probably spend far too much time on our phones now because it was all we had during the pandemic. So we need to find balanced, positive ways to support children and young people have better alternatives. There's definitely an increase. We can see that. There's definitely, I mean, you might talk about it. It's almost like an addiction for lots of children and young people now. And for many, where their social skills and their confidence have been impacted, it's an easier and more comfortable way to have some sort of social interaction. And again, we need to think about what alternatives we can build for children and families. In terms of online safety, particularly when it comes to sexual exploitation and what children are seeing, we need to place a much greater responsibility and, you know, we need to get the social media companies to take that much more seriously. It is literally everybody's job make sure that children are safe, and we don't see social media companies doing enough. We need to take it much more seriously. It's incredibly harmful, and we are hearing of very young children accessing information or seeing things that they're not necessarily going looking for, but that they come across, and we need to find ways to try and address that. It's a real concern.
Thank you. I'm afraid we must move on from that. We have got Paul Kane around public health priorities. Paul, If you take us, manage to take us up to 11 o'clock, I might give you an extra couple of minutes if I can. But sorry that you've been at the tail end of a long session, Paul.
Thank you, convener. And, you know, I think in some ways, actually, ending session of health, I think actually is quite helpful, because I think a lot of what we've spoken about this morning is about interventions and the need to make interventions in the lives of children and young people. And I think this committee particularly is really focused on what positive interventions in terms of policy and legislation can make the most difference. So I suppose I'm keen from a public health point of view to understand, in terms of tackling issues like obesity, drugs and alcohol misuse, non-communicable diseases later in life, you know, what do panel members feel will make the most difference in terms of interventions? And I suppose if I can just wrap up in that, how do we get to a place where these interventions aren't kind of standalone or kind of in a silo, but actually are holistic and go across the piece in terms of family support and working cross team? I think someone had mentioned no wrong door, and I think that's key to this. So perhaps if we can just consider those themes to take us up to our time. And maybe if I can start with Mary Glasgow.
Thank you very much. Thank you, convener. I think, as we've heard this morning, one of the biggest challenges we have, and one of the single biggest things that will make a difference, is addressing poverty. Poverty underpins all of the other public health challenges and inequalities that we've talked about today. So I think a real drive to address poverty, to make sure that we don't forget the links between health inequalities and challenges that cost us later in the long term that are started and underpinned by poverty, would be a really important place to start. I also think, and we've talked a lot about the importance of normalising the need for support when it comes to child reading. So many of us have, you know, so many supports that you can call upon, whether it's in your community or within your extended family, and that really helps you raise your children, because it's really challenging at times for most families. For many of our families, for many of our communities, we don't have those existing networks. So this investment in what we've described as whole family support is crucial to address public health inequalities. It's crucial to make sure that it's informed by understanding poverty, where it has practical offers to families, where they can access early help and support easily, without stigma, without having to jump through hoops, without having to go through or be bounced around different agencies and different systems, and get access to help that make sure that understand that professionals understand the impact of childhood adversity and trauma on parents and family life. People, you know, recognising that parents and carers use drugs or alcohol or have mental distress, and that many of the reasons for that are rooted in their own childhood experiences that they've not had opportunity to recover from. Really good quality whole family support is practical, emotional and financial help to strengthen family relationships. I think the biggest message that we would want to give from Children First on behalf of the families that we support is that the families, the carers and parents we support love their children. They want their children to do well. They just have many more challenges than the rest of us to overcome, and there are not easily accessible supports to help them overcome them. That we really need to focus and get passionate on the delivery of the promise, that we need to take a rights-based approach through the UNCRC, and that we need to make sure that every child and young person, every parent and carer, can ask for help in a non-stigmatised way and get that support in a way that makes sense to them, which is kind, compassionate, child-centred, but family-minded, and recognises that children live in families, families make up communities, and communities are the backbone of our society, and we really need to invest massively in that whole family support that we've described. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I bring in Heather?
Yeah, I just wanted to fly my little health psychology flag, because I think as what we've all spoke about today in this session is really thinking about behaviour, isn't it? And it's the behaviour of people, whether that be the workforce who are trying to engage and deliver person-centred care, whether that be systems trying to change and adapt to meet the requirements and needs of children and young people, and whether that be policymakers who are making the decisions about what best policy and interventions to deliver and certain change and things. So that's all behaviour, and it's all behaviour change. And I think if we can pull on a lot of information and knowledge and theories and models from behavioural science and health psychology to inform us to, and for us to be more psychologically informed on how we deliver these services, we're more likely to see more positive outcomes, because it pulls on those basic principles of how we listen, how we support people, how we collaborate with people rather than telling them what to do, how we can support them to problem solve and think of their own solutions to their the problems that they're experiencing, how we can instill hope, acceptance and trust and security and safety within the systems that are supporting people. And then again, as I said before, people more likely thrive and flourish within that. So a little bit of self-promotion, sorry.
Thank you. Paul, I'm wondering, in terms of a supplementary, I wonder if we can maybe round off, just maybe by asking, to round the panels and ask them what they think, as a result of everything that we've heard today, what we could focus our efforts on in particular. Are you happy for me to pose that question on your behalf? Because I think that would be really useful. I mean, obviously, it's a very broad session. If I can just go round everyone and just say, in terms of what we can do as a committee to really drill down on something in regards to children and young people's health outcomes, where could we add value? But maybe just go around everyone individually. We've come to Professor Borland first of all.
I think that's an excellent question, Convener, and I think my response to that would be anything we can do to tackle poverty. We've heard from everybody today that it underlies everything, so whatever we can do to tackle poverty in the way that it impacts on children, young people and families, and taking a whole family approach, those probably would be my key messages.
Thank you. Can I come to Heather?
I think very similar, and probably very similar to all my colleagues will say. I think the tackling poverty is that's the underpinning of all of our basic needs, and then our basic psychological needs for us to be able to develop and thrive is so important. So yeah.
Thank you. Mary.
Poverty, first and foremost, underpinning that investment in whole family support, making sure that we bridge the gap between universal services and acute services for children who are emotionally distressed. But most importantly, I think the committee can add value by scrutinising the delivery of the promise. The promise is, you know, it's a thing of beauty. It makes a strong commitment to the children and young people of Scotland. It needs to be delivered. It needs investment to be delivered. And I think one of the ways in which this committee can add value is to make sure that we do deliver on the promise that was made to children and young people, that where they are loved and safe, they must stay within their own families, and that the country must do all it can to ensure that parents and carers and families get all the support, all the emotional, financial and practical support that they need in order to fulfil that commitment and that promise. And also that we maintain a focus on repair and recovery from what has been a collectively traumatising event of this pandemic. So those would be my key asks. Thank you.
Thank you. And Kirsty Louise.
I would just echo what others have said, particularly on the issue of poverty. And I think one issue that we've talked about throughout the session is that need for resourcing properly early intervention and investment in family support. I think that's really key. I think to be becoming, having a shift in our focus towards prevention, and as Mary Glasgow just very well articulated, that need to focus on making sure that the promise is kept as well. So yeah, I think that would be a key focus, and where the committee could really have some good input on making sure that remains a focus for this parliamentary session.
Thank you. Jackie.
I think, you know, from all those contributions to your very insightful question, I would just echo the approach to strengthen families within the communities. So it's about, you know, securing children within the families that they live with, within the communities that they live into, and that focus on what really works for families, what works for them, in a non-stigmatised way, certainly.
Thank you. And finally, Suzanne.
Thank you. I think obviously poverty is the issue, but let's give children and families access to free physical and leisure activities with support in place. Let's give children and young people somewhere to play, to have fun, to thrive with support, and really kind of recover from this pandemic.
Okay, thank you. Thank you all this morning for everything that you've told us. As usual, we could go on for a lot longer, but we must break now. We're going to suspend the session until 11:15 because we have got more evidence to take on another issue. So if we suspend till 11:15, thank you all. Our third item today is an evidence session with the Scottish Government on the draft transvaginal mesh removal reimbursement scheme, of which the Cabinet Secretary sent to the committee in December 2021, and of course comes off the back of our scrutiny of the bill. And so I welcome back to the committee Greg Chalmers, the head of Chief Medical Officer's Policy Division, Terry O'Kelly, the Senior Medical Advisor, David Bishop, the Mesh Team Leader, and Ailsa Garland, Solicitor for the Scottish Government. Thank you all for your offer of coming back and taking us through the scheme and some of the issues that we raised in our Stage 1 report. I think I'd like to start by just asking if you could take us through the crowdfunding issue. Obviously, that was something that came up when we took evidence. So, some of the women affected crowdfunded for their surgery. So there were some questions that we had around how that might be dealt with if people had gone through the crowdfunding route. I'm not quite sure who I should go to first, but maybe I can come to Terry O'Kelly first, if you can just explain how crowdfunding is going to be dealt with. And if there's anyone you want to defer to, then please do so.
Convener, thank you very much, and welcome from Aberdeen. I think if it's not unreasonable, I think Greg Chalmers is probably the best. This is sort of a policy issue rather than a clinical issue.
Okay, let's thank you.
Feel his thunder.
Greg, over to you. Thank you.
Good morning, Convener. Good morning, committee members. Happy New Year. Very pleased to come back to speak to you again today about the bill and the reimbursement scheme. So yes, come directly to crowdfunding, this was one of the issues you raised in your Stage 1 report, and we gave consideration to the different circumstances in which individuals will have received money from other people to help their to help meet the costs of the mesh removal surgery. So in relation to that, the conclusion that the government reached was to distinguish essentially between private arrangements and arrangements that were in essence public. So in relation to, and I recall you just, the committee discussed this with the Cabinet Secretary, in relation to the arrangements were essentially private, for example, between family members, it seemed to us, to the government, most sensible to not get involved in those, to allow those family arrangements to be dealt with privately, and for any monies granted to be distributed privately between family members, which, because families come in all shapes and sizes and different arrangements. So that was our view on that. In relation to public and quasi-public arrangements, we did think it reasonable, and this is addressed in the reimbursement scheme, that where monies have been raised publicly, essentially through a kind of a recorded quasi-public route, like a crowdfunding website, it is reasonable to expect applicants to declare that they've received monies through that route, through those sorts of routes. In part because websites, crowdfunding websites, will generally have recorded what's happened, even if individuals quite possibly didn't retain the receipts or the documentation at the time, the information is recoverable. And can be got from the organizer of the website. So in those circumstances, we do think it's reasonable for those monies to be declared, partly because it's recoverable, and partly because where private people make voluntary donations to the cost of somebody that they know, but maybe distantly or through social media, I think the government did consider that it is reasonable that those individuals didn't expect to get the money back. It was a purely charitable donation. So that's the balance that we came to on that. As I say, it is recorded in the scheme in paragraphs 17.1 and 17.2.
Yeah, and then of course people might have raised funds or are coming to, you know, from a various sources as well. Just before I allow my colleagues to come in, I mean, how are we going to make sure that the process isn't overly burdensome for individuals, some of whom are obviously recovering from surgery? I mean, how are you going to facilitate it so that they really don't find it a burdensome task?
Yeah, no, that's a very fair point. And you know, I suppose one thing which we take encouragement from in this area is that NSS, who will be operating the scheme, they've got a fair amount of experience in this area now. So, for example, when individuals have been making applications to the existing Scottish Government Mesh Fund, there have been, you know, there will be occasions when applications were incomplete for one reason or another, possibly for the reason you give, convener, and in those circumstances NSS has worked with people to make sure that the application is complete to get additional information. So we plan, and certainly NSS plan, to proceed in the same way here. You know, these applications will be made in good faith, you know, sincerely, and if it so happens that there is, in relation to this or in relation to something else, for example, you know, travel receipts, you know, we'll make best endeavours to support people to find or help us find the information they need.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I pass over to my colleague Gillian Mackay, who's got questions around the flexibility of the scheme? Gillian.
Thank you, convener. Can the panel provide more detail on the exceptional circumstances provision at paragraph 16? And could it provide an example of circumstances which may require this provision to be used?
Again, panel members, I don't know if Greg wants to go in first. Yes, Greg.
Yep. No, sorry about that. Sorry for talking there. I suppose the purpose of paragraph 16 is to give the administrator NSS that scope for flexibility that it needs in relation to all of the different circumstances that will have transpired in people travelling some way to get their surgery, whether in the UK or internationally. And you know, in terms of flexibilities, I mean, for example, as you'd expect, we specify in the draft scheme that reasonable travel costs are, generally speaking, economy class travel or you know, standard class hotel rooms of the type that one would ordinarily use. But of course, you know, one can't know all of the circumstances that have you know, been involved in each situation. So, for example, if it so happens that for one reason or another that there wasn't a standard class room available in a hotel in the United States in a particular period, or for one reason or another it was necessary for somebody in particular pain or discomfort to be upgraded in the air transport, so that they so happen not to travel what we would understand as, you would all understand as, you know, economy class. Then if the circumstances were reasonable and there was an explanation that made sense, then we would have NSS would have flexibility to pay that bit more. So it's really to give NSS kind of common sense flexibility to take account of things that, you know, had happened out with the control of the applicant.
Gillian, do you have any other questions you want to ask?
Just, Just very briefly, Convener, thank you. Given that many of the women who travelled didn't expect to be reimbursed, do we believe that there is sufficient flexibility to address the many different situations that may arise to ensure that anyone who would claim under this scheme will be covered? Greg?
We'll just unmute Greg, please. Broadcasting, thank you. There we go.
See, I mean, as I was saying, we certainly hope so. So, for example, we're conscious that individuals, and why would they, won't have kept receipts for meals, very likely won't have kept receipts for taxis, those, you know, smaller, but smaller items individually, but which in aggregates will add up over a period of a few days. Or up to a week when people are travelling. So we do hope that for those smaller items where people won't have kept receipts, the exceptional circumstances will be wide enough. I mean, I think it is reasonable to expect that even if people didn't keep, you know, plane tickets, and indeed, you know, people don't get plane tickets these days, but you know, people make larger expenditures, even if they don't keep receipts, they will have bank statements that they can draw upon for those larger amounts. And of course, given that we know where the surgery has taken place in general, we would hope to be able to get, if it so happens that people haven't kept receipts of the actual surgery costs, which I expect they probably will have, but nonetheless, we would be able to get that information from the surgery provider. So in general, we hope there's sufficient scope for exceptional circumstances. But I suppose one thing to say is that because this is an administrative scheme, we will have scope. If something transpires that we genuinely didn't anticipate, we would have scope to remake the scheme to add to it, as we did in the case of the Scottish Government Mesh Fund. After the Mesh Fund had been operating for a while, it transpired that some women had mesh implanted in a private hospital, which at the outset we weren't aware of. But because of the scheme was made administratively, we were able to amend it very quickly and bring those people within the scope of the existing Mesh Fund. So we'd have that option here too.
That's great. Thank you. And thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Gillian. Can I now move on to questions from Sue Webber around medical issues arising from mesh surgery? Sue.
Yes, thanks very much, Convener. I'm a bit confused, I think, and maybe it might just be first day back or first committee back, but it's in relation to the other costs. And I was wondering if someone could explain the rationale behind only allowing treatment for any complications arising directly from the mesh removal surgery to be reimbursed, whereas medical issues arising as a result of mesh removal surgery will not be reimbursed. What's the difference, and why are we reimbursing one and not the other? I suppose that's my main question.
Greg?
Yep, I'm happy to start on that, and then I think I will, if Terry doesn't mind, hand over to him to describe the to address the more clinical aspects of that. So, I mean, what we're trying to get at here is to make a distinction between issues immediately arising from the surgery, and I suppose I should say that in that regard, that we're not actually aware of there being issues immediately arising. So, in essence, if there's been something that's happened during the surgery that needs immediate attention afterwards, you know, to put it in layman's term, something's gone not quite right and needs to be addressed immediately afterwards. And to draw a distinction between that and, in essence, the care and healthcare that we'd offer to patients on their return to Scotland. so the kind of continuing care that all individuals can access from the NHS, that we would expect individuals to access through the NHS, as everyone else does. But maybe I'll let Terry come in there to kind of better explain the distinction there.
So I think if somebody had an operation, the scheme is specifically addressing reimbursement for mesh removal. And therefore, it's entirely appropriate to think that if there is a complication or an issue related to that procedure, let's say a surgical site infection or some other issue resulting in the patient, a woman returning to theatre or having to have additional length of stay, something like that, that is entirely appropriate that is reimbursed. I think for a number of women, there will be ongoing problems. I think the women themselves have, we've seen correspondence and requests that women are linked to local services and the national MDT, so that their future care is taken forward in a coherent and seamless fashion. And that will involve perhaps pain management, if that perhaps involve psychological, psychosexual issues, and also perhaps further urological surgery. So the reimbursement is about the primary procedure to remove the mesh and what surrounds that, and the expenses related to that, rather than additional issues that might have been taken care of beforehand or subsequently.
Okay, I think I've got that. Yeah. It's a very subtle, isn't it? Just the way the language is there, Terry, it's quite...
I do absolutely agree. And I think what Greg has, the issue really is about the way the scheme is applied. I think we are hoping that that will be as flexible as possible, and that each individual case will be assessed on its own merits, because the cases will differ, undoubtedly.
So, Kavina, can I have another question?
Sure.
Thanks. Is it acceptable that long-term care is not reimbursable under the scheme if the long-term care was required because of that original mesh surgery, the implantation surgery, not the removal?
Right. So the bill specifically addresses mesh removal rather than other aspects of care for women.
Yeah, I suppose I'm just saying if that patient has got some significant issues from that original surgery, but are you suggesting that would then hopefully the treatment would be carried out under the new Scottish mesh?
Yes, I think she's absolutely right, or will be accessible locally. What we're hoping is the service, now we've got a centre, and that's aligned to the other centres of the United Kingdom, that this will act as a hub and spoke, that patients will attend and be referred to and consult, and centre will be consulted with as need be, but the patients will be able to hopefully access as much care as possible locally. And the long-term issues, psychosexual, psychological, etc., they don't, the centre will develop, I think, over time, expertise in specific aspects of that, but these areas of care are accessible and have been accessible through the NHS and throughout Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom. What we've added to that is specialist centres for the act of mesh removal, associated issues around that, reconstructive surgery, etc.
Okay, thank you very much. That's great. Thanks, Terry.
Thank you, Sue. And now can I move on to David Torrance? I just realised that Emma Harper has asked for a supplementary on Sue's issues there. Emma, thank you.
Thanks, convener. It's just a quick clarification question for Dr. O'Kelly. If a person needed anticoagulant therapy, so they needed an extended pre-op assessment, or then even that affected their post-op in a delayed discharge because you have to manage anticoagulants, for instance, that would be part of the mesh removal procedure, so that would be covered. Is that correct?
That would be my understanding, yes. And I, you know, it would be very difficult not to support that.
Okay, and then the other question, which is kind of on the flip side of that, is if somebody acquired a complication because of mesh removal surgery, like urethral transection or something in the ureter that required then an additional surgery, like a urostomy, is that covered? Because that would be something that happened because of the mesh removal surgery.
I think my understanding is, a belief is that it would not necessarily be covered unless it was an immediate problem which required urgent or emergency care. I think the longer term aspects of urinary diversion or other major urological reconstructive surgery, I'm not sure how much of that goes on in the private sector or has gone on in the private sector, but I think this is care one would expect. And I think when I gave my evidence previously, this is the care for major centres with all available resources. And that's care that we would have anticipated would have been picked up by the NHS and in the future will also be under the auspices of the NHS.
Okay, but if there was
a urethral injury or urological injury at the time of mesh removal and that had to be corrected at that time, then yeah, for sure that should be reimbursed. But that won't, I don't think, necessarily involve the care that you've suggested. It might do, but it would be a very rare occurrence, I think.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. And now. David Torrance has a couple of questions. David.
Thank you, Convener. And my question is for Greg. Some of the women will have taken out loans or used credit cards or even in some areas remortgaged houses. The costs incurred through interest payments from the loans, will they be eligible for reimbursement?
Greg.
In general, yes. In general, yes. That's the policy intention. We will be looking to the to the kind of cumulative is a big word, but we're looking to the individual circumstances and the way in which individuals have raised the money, and that might well involve interest repayments and interest payments made in relation to that. And I think, as Terry said already, our general approach here is to maintain as much flexibility as we can in terms of the administration of the scheme, and certainly where individuals have entered into credit agreements and other sorts of financial instruments, the cost to the person is what will be considered within the broad scope of reasonableness. I should always say that. That we need, as the minister said in his evidence, we do of course need to keep a balancing eye on the use of public funds. So, but I would fully expect that actions that people have taken in these circumstances will have been reasonable.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm not seeing any other members wanting to ask questions, so I'll thank you all for your time this morning. And once again, thank you for giving us sight of the scheme. And we'll move on to our next item. Thank you. So our next, fourth item on our agenda is a consideration of a negative instrument to Abortion Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021. These regulations amend the 1991 regulations to enable the notice of termination that's sent to the Chief Medical Officer to be given electronically and extend the deadline for giving notice. They also reduce the information that must be provided as part of the notification. Now, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument, made no recommendations and no motions to annul have been received in relation to this instrument. I'd just like to ask members if they've got any comments in relation to this instrument they'd like to put on the record. No. Nobody has any comments. Thank you. So I propose, therefore, the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? No.
they don't. So that's we agree not to make any recommendation, apologies. At our next meeting on the 18th of January, the committee will take evidence from stakeholders as part of our inquiry into the health and wellbeing of children and young people. And we'll also take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care on the provisional common framework on public health protection and health security. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.